Thank you. I like that. Our previous model had a covariance matrix that was not positive definite. Yeah, if you remember my pun about that, so if someone says, are you positive? I'm like, no, I'm not definite. I'm not positive definite. It happens with multiple factors occasionally. It usually means something's wrong in the specification of the model. There aren't obvious fixes when you get this analysis. By the way, this also shows up in other contexts. How many of you have heard of hierarchical linear models, multi-level models, mixed models? Teaching a class with mixed models this fall, it's going to be amazing. Anyway, the random effects covariance matrix, which actually was what we call the factor covariance matrix, will blow up sometimes too if you don't have a random slope or a random component to it. So what we're going to try to fix this, the first thing we're going to try is to make the factors uncorrelated. We're going to force them to be zero correlation because that thing is invertible. It's not going to fit well, most likely, because the factors are going to be correlated, but it's going to be invertible. It's going to help us look for model misfit a little bit more. But then at that point, once we look for model misfit, we could add more factors, we could drop items, we can work things work. The other thing we could do is we could simplify our model with a factor covariance structure that may have like a higher order factor, which takes why this is an issue is sometimes related to how many factors we have. We may have overfit our data. We have 6 covariances to estimate, 6 correlations to estimate with this thing. And actually, we're estimating the factors' variances as well. So we have a total of 10 things to estimate there. That's a lot. A simpler model will cut down on the number of things we need to estimate, which usually makes it invertible. So we're going to try all 3 of these things, okay? Exciting. Not quite a bunny in a bathtub with floppy ears, I know.
It'll have to do.
So we're going to take that 4 factors. We're going to start with the uncorrelated factors. Here's the syntax from before. If we add, remember when I started the class and I said, hey, estimate this model with independent items or something like that, with factors all equal, the correlations all equal to 0. We use that syntax here. And it brings up another point. Once you define a factor in Levon, right here, we defined it with the equal tilde, it acts like a variable, like another variable in the analysis. So if we wanted to set the correlation between Q1.SE1 and Q1.SE2 equal to 0, we'd use this similar type of syntax. We'd say first variable double tilde second variable, and we put a 0 star in front of the second variable. So remember that as we go forward. Once you define a factor, it acts like a variable, and so anything that you would do with a variable, predict it, do something with its variance, do something with its covariance, it works the same. Right? And there, oh, by the way, I just gave away next week's lecture. That's SEM for you, right? We have things that are latent. We have things that are observed. In the end, we want to do a regression with a combination of them. The last line of it looks like a regression like we started the Levon with. It's just some things are factors and some things are observed. Kind of crazy. So, you wouldn't publish this model, right? Bless you. You would not go out in the world and say, I have uncorrelated factors. That's bad. And in some domains, it's really bad. When I grew up in grad school, I haven't grown up yet, but when I was in grad school, we had an old faculty member at Illinois. And by old, I mean it was late 80s, he'd come to work. He was emeritus, but he loved what he did. His name was Lloyd Humphreys. I don't know if you've heard of him. He's fairly well-known in the measurement of intelligence, I think, some other personality traits. And he had been fairly well regarded, and one of his things was, everything has to be correlated somehow. You got to have some correlation. If you're measuring from the same person, they're all related because of the person, right, at the very least. So you would never publish this model. But let's take a look at the model fit real quick. The model fit is predictably horrible, right? So you might be thinking to yourself, wait a minute, we went and fit 4 one-factor models, and they were all perfect in terms of fit. Almost, you couldn't get better fit. Right? And now we put them together into this four-factor model, and we're having a hard time getting it to run. And then when we get it to run, we have this terrible model fit. What are we doing wrong?
Crossing the
streams. That's right. Somewhere in the back of class, maybe you're videoing with him. Billy's like, ha ha. Ha ha. We don't do multidimensional models. Right? But wait. There's more. Hey, take a look. We set the covariance matrix of the factors to zero. Take a look at this. This is the fitted covariance model matrix. This is the model predicted covariances. Oh. Take a look at these things. Right? Here are all the items that measure the first factor. And they have a predicted covariance matrix. But they have zero covariance with the other items, right? That's that block diagonal, right? We fix the factor covariance equal to zero. So we are saying by our model, we're implying that our first six items only covary with those, and with everything else, they don't covary. That's a problem. That's where misfit's going to happen, right? So you can see there's the first six, that block. Here's the second six. This is factor two right here. There's the third six, that's factor three. I can't get all the way down to the fourth six for factor four, but you can see that. So that's not what's supposed to happen. All right, so I thought I'd show you that. It's kind of a neat thing to see. So let's take a look at the normalized residuals here. And sure enough, if you look here, here's the first block, right? Here's the first six items. This is the first self-efficacy question, right? The normalized residuals within this block are very, very tiny. But take a look at the normalized residuals outside of the block. Very big. Right? So we need factor covariances is what this is telling us. Same thing with this second block right here. Normalized residuals in here are very tiny. Outside of it, very big. Factor covariances would solve that problem. So how do we add back factor covariances? Well, let's go back to the model where the factor covariances came from. We can actually use it, even though we'd never report it, we can use it to inspect the results. And we can look at the residuals and see if there's something that tells us that we've missed something. All right, so here are our normalized residuals for this first factor. So let's take a look at question one, self-esteem one. All right, here we go. Mostly small. Wait, here's the big one. Mostly small. Oh, wait, there's a big one. Oh, there's a big one. Do you notice a trend here with what correlations we're missing on?
The other.
That's right. The other questions asked about math problem number one. Ooh, wait a minute. Let's take a look at number two here. Here's question two, math problem number two. Here is self-esteem 2. Yep, that's big. Self-esteem 3, that's not as big. Self-esteem 4, that's big. And in fact, if we take this little band right here in the covariance matrix, these are all the other questions. Those are big. Right here. Whoa, big, right? Big. We have an effective question that we probably could have predicted. I think Hong Ling predicted before. That makes sense, right? We ask people to focus on this one math problem and we ask them four questions about it. This is telling us the math problem is inducing correlation or extra covariance in their result. So that's the normalized residuals. Take a look at the modification indices. This is the top 40. This is like, does anyone remember Casey Kasem? Or is it Rick Dees that you remember? No? Anyone know Rick Dees? Oh, yeah. Slaving over a hot microphone? No, never mind. Anyway, sorry. I believe that's a radio joke. What's that? I'm really old. That's what I used to deliver papers to. One of my first jobs, paper route. Okay, but take a look here. This modification index is saying there's some type of covariance we're missing between this top one is math item 4, it's the self-esteem 2 item and the self-efficacy 3 item. So it's kind of odd. There's a lot of stuff going on here. But wherever we see the same item, Q, Q5 on either side of this. That's telling us we're looking at extra covariance between these. And this is telling us we need to add that residual covariance to model it. Now, that's residual. That's a lot of residual covariances. But if you go all the way down here, you, the first time that you see a place where the item on one side is not equal to the item on the other is the 37th largest. That means the top 36 are all the covariances that go with the inter-question deals. And for each question, help me out here, there are six. Right? Are there six of them? Yeah, six times six. Yeah, so that's all 36 of them. That's where the misfit's happening. So what do we do? So here, this is what kind of putting those two pieces of information together. Model 02A, that was the blown up model, globally said it didn't work. There was some type of misspecification going on. So we switched to model 02B, where we had no covariances, to get it to run, and we saw locally it didn't fit. We need the covariances there. So we switched back to model 2A and look at locally, and it looks like the model, the math question has an effect. So we got to do something to incorporate the effect of the question, the common stimulus for each of the four questions, the self-efficacy items. So is this capitalizing on chance, Jennifer? This is fine. Nah. All right. So one thing I wanted to note, what our model was telling us to do was to add a residual covariance. And I wanted to bring back a picture from the Brown book from a couple of weeks ago. That residual covariance is like saying perhaps there's another factor. Right, and what we had mentioned to start class, I think I drew an equation up here on the board, was that whenever you add multiple factors measuring the same items, it adds to your covariance terms. So I would like to talk and say, hey, you know, this set of modification indices are informative because they're adding, telling us to add residual covariances, but they're never going to tell us to add a factor that isn't there. But let's go and treat those within the math item as an item factor, or what we would call a method factor, methods factor, right? Each item is its own unique source of covariance above and beyond the self-efficacy item themselves, so each math problem, right? So we've got question type of variance, and we've got math problem type of variance. Speaking of things on the board, I'm looking at remnants. I just, something caught my eye for remnants here. Maybe this is tentative conspiracy theory sign up. Number 10, CIA created AIDS. Number 11, Holocaust not real. Who was in this class before us? Right. Number 12, factors don't exist. Anyway, so is everybody following this? It starts to make sense a little bit, right? So our survey was designed in such a way where we have this additional set of things that influence responses, right? And we're going to try to develop method factors to fix it. Question.
Potentially stupid question.
No such thing.
I saw methods factor, mm-hmm. And my mind jumped to like a multi-method matrix. Does,
yeah,
that tie into that?
It does. Yeah, I believe it does. I'm worse with understanding. I don't know the literature on that very well. But yes, that is actually when the postdoc came to me. She said, I was told I need to do a multi-trait, multi-method matrix for this. What we're going to do is specify kind of the factor analytic analog of that. It's going to be with these data. We don't need to go and separate the data into covariances and so forth. We're just going to specify the factors that would imply a multi-trait, multi-method matrix for it. That cool?
Mm-hmm.
Sweet. Other thoughts? Anybody else do multi-trait, multi-method? Nah. But yes, good point. This is actually a very good point to it. It's where I didn't do my reading very well in grad school. Like, nah, multi-trait, multi-method. I mean, I love multidimensionality, but only so much. So the first grant I won, I claimed I was going to do that with diagnostic models. I don't know it very well, so it's terrible. Now you get to see all the ugly weaknesses of template. I can't keep up with Skorupski if I'm doing so bad. I need to up my game. Anyway, what's that look for? You could just tell him I'm really jealous and I'm trying to up my game, catch him. I'll never catch him race-wise, but you know. No. All right, so method factors are latent constructs. I put latent in quotes. They're a way that we can trick an analysis to go and provide us with an additional set thing to model our covariance. All right, we're not interested in understanding the effect of items here. It's a nuisance. But what we're interested in is people's self-efficacy for answering those items. And we can't disentangle items from the self-efficacy questions in terms of a design, right? It'd be very hard to write a design that wouldn't be influenced by items because you have to have that item as a context to ask self-efficacy for. So what we need to do is create a statistical way of controlling for the effect of these nuisance dimensions. Perhaps for your data, this might be reverse coded items, right? We would have a reverse coded method factor. Could be other things as well. Could be a form factor, right? Maybe you have some overlapping items, very unique items on different forms themselves. Right? If you were in an item response model class or you're in advanced IRT, you may have heard of this being a testlet effect. These are testlet factors as well. Right? Method factors are typically uncorrelated with the factors of interest, right? It's a questionable circumstance here, but a lot of times they're just on their own. Like, why would reverse coding, for instance, be related to gambling? Doesn't think. Here we might have a correlation. We could test for it, although I don't. But in other places, we may not. Most of the times we don't. So what we're going to do is we're going to create 6 new factors. We're going to have a 10-factor model. Yeah, right? Did you say overfit? We're going to create a method factor for each of these 6 mathematics items. Right? So remember, each item had 4 questions to it. Question 1 was measuring the first self-esteem factor. Question 2 was the second, and so forth. So now, for each question, we're going to have a self-esteem factor it measures and a math problem factor. So it's going to be measuring 2 things at once. Right. How many of you have been told before a good item only measures 1 thing at a time? Right? We're violating that willfully here because there are things that interfere with it itself. So questions? Any question about this? How does the syntax look? Verbose, I think you'd say. We have the original 4-factor model. Then we have the additional 6 question factors. And here, each one of these factors is measured by the 4 self-efficacy items that was asked on it. All right, so you'll see each item, for instance, Q1 SE1 appears twice. To keep this factor uncorrelated with all the self-efficacy factors, we have to then specify that the covariance here is set to 0 for each one of these right here. And that's what the last bit of syntax does. We could relax that, but for right now, we're going to keep it that way as is traditional. But what this is doing is it's saying, yeah, the question factors are all interrelated. And they should be. They're measuring math, right? There may be some higher order math domain thing they're measuring. On the other flip of it, the self-efficacy factors are all correlated, if it'll let us estimate it. Is everybody following? Seems to be straightforward. Let's take a look at the model fit. Wait a minute. Did I just see what I think I saw? Look at that likelihood ratio test. All right? Not only the p-value is 0.292. Now here, I've literally got goosebumps here. I know it's crazy, right? I've done this long enough to be excited about silly results like this. This is not simulated data. This is real data, right? That's a likelihood ratio test that says our model fits as well as the saturated model, right? Which is amazing, considering what's the difference in parameters between our model and the saturated model? 207. That is a huge number. Now, do you see why I got goosebumps? Right? Last week, I was just telling you it's really hard to get things to work well when you have extra, all these degrees of freedom. I mentioned sort of sometimes that people will design factors with only 3 items because there's so few degrees of freedom they can make it fit. there are 207 degrees of freedom here, and we fit as well as the saturated model. That, to me, is pretty cool. Is that overfitting? No, it's not, because we have 207 places that we're not overfitting. Sorry. I'm not picking on you. I'm picking on the reviewers that have had. Dang you, reviewer three. If you, I'm going to show you something that you don't necessarily have to watch. I'm not going to make you watch it, but have you looked at, there's a movie about Adolf Hitler that's in German, that's common, an internet meme of it, but subtitles get swapped out.
Downfall.
Downfall, is it? Reviewer three. If you look up this right here, this is Adolf Hitler cussing at. I guess I'm making
shouldn't
you watch
what
it.
Makes each of us unique also make our treatment unique? Advanced?
He does not like Reviewer 3.
Der Feind operiert jetzt am nördlichen Stadtrand zwischen Donau und Pankow. Und im Osten ist der Feind bis zur Linie Richtung Lake Marzlau Krauss-Horst gelangt.
Mit dem Angriff scheint das alles in Ordnung zu kommen.
Magierer. Steiner. Steiner konnte nicht genügend Kräfte für einen Angriff massieren. Der Angriff Steiner ist nicht erfolgt.
Sorry. Just one more little bit and I'll stop it. It goes on.
This bleibt im Raum. Kalte, neue, Kriegs.
Sorry. Not safe for work, but I did it anyway. You get the point. Sorry, Jake, what you mentioned when you said overfit was that was me right there. Overfit! Sorry. This is why 207 parameters is pretty amazing. I found this to be like, this is why this is your example. As soon as this happened, I said to her, this was just in January, I said, can I use your data for my class example? This is amazing. Oh my gosh. It not only didn't break, because it's a huge, a 10-factor model, right? There's a ton of parameters in it, but it also fit well for it. So yeah, now we're just gonna pile on. Are you ready? Remember that good fit we saw before with when we had the single factor model, the RMSEA? Oh, that's amazing. The CFI and TLI? Nice. We have a well-fitting model here. Oh my goodness. Whew. That's actually, I think she was like, oh. Awesome. So, no large residual, normalized residual covariances either. Pretty cool. So, that's now all of a sudden we have this 10-factor model. I'm calling model 3 here. That we're going to compare what we say is our model, right? Hey, we have model fit now. And so one of the things that you typically go when you do a multiple factor analysis, one of the more customary routine fit analyses that you do as a comparison is to say, yeah, I think it's probably toward the overfit question. Are you doing what a one-factor model would do? Right, so you take that one-factor model, even though it didn't do absolute fit and we really shouldn't use it, we're going to do a model comparison between the one-factor model and our now 10-factor model itself. And so I use the ANOVA function, and there's, sure enough, the difference is on 45 degrees of freedom, our difference is astronomical right there. So, pretty cool, huh? Anyone impressed? Not really. Anyone get goosebumps? No. And here's a picture. I asked you to do a picture for homework 4. Levon and R, the SEM plot thing, is so kludgy, it's frustrating. But it's way better than having to draw all this by hand. So I did it. I will tell you, if you use M+, the diagrammer in M+, if you're using Windows, I don't believe it works in Mac or Unix or Linux, but if you're using Windows, it works much better than this diagrammer here. There's our picture. So, we got model fit. Well, here's the next thing, right? We found we have four dimensions of self-efficacy. Understanding and information and problem solving, and there was another one. Like me trying to figure out who the Beatles were. Right? Ringo and John and Paul and that other guy, right? Anyway, George, right? I know. Now, somewhere Skrupski's cursing at me again. Damn you, Templin. Anyway. I'm not a big Beatles fan. It's okay. I know it's blasphemy, right? I like Elvis. Does that help? But we have four. We were trying to measure one. How do we synthesize that? What we can do is build a higher order factor model. What we could say is, yeah, there are four main dimensions to self-efficacy, but perhaps these four are actually measuring one overall dimension of self-efficacy, right? Not the items. The items are measuring these four dimensions of it, but maybe what we have is a self-efficacy factor on top of it. A higher order factor is what we call it. So what we can do is build a higher order factor model. And a higher order factor model, same sequence of steps, the higher order factor model is an augmentation to the model we just fit. If you think about this model that we just fit, take a look at this. There's lots of green arrows here. It's like St. Patrick's Day, but we're in Easter. I think we're part of the University of North Texas, right? Being green up here, right? What that happens to represent, if these were items, right? That's weird. If we had four items, this would be a saturated model for the covariance matrix of those items, right? The higher order factor model treats the factors as its items. So if we put a higher order factor here, one dimension, it's going to be one factor measured by four, essentially, items. So which model will fit better? Saturated model again, right? So the model we just fit has to fit better than it will fit either better or equal to the higher order model itself. But the higher order model is nested within the saturated model. So it's an odd thing. It's like we just went to the most complex version of it, and now we're going to simplify it a bit by putting a higher order factor to it. So if we were to compare, and what we have to do is compare the higher order factor model to the saturated factor model. So this is now our model of comparison. This is our model of record itself. All right, there's the overall saturated model. That's always lurking. But now if we're going to compare and contrast models, if we're going to say there's a higher order factor, the way that we test it is we say, hey, do we need 10 covariances, or can we get by with putting a factor in their place? Okay. So just like we did with items, just piled on layers and layers and layers of it. Questions? Okay. So this is what we have right now. This is kind of a picture. Again, fuchsia. Thanks, Lisa. Appreciate it. And this is a higher order factor for it. Right, so here we would have a factor on the top measured by each of these lower first order factors. The thing about the higher order factor is the rules of identification still apply. How many items did you need to identify a factor? Three. Right? So we need to have three factors now to identify our higher order factor itself. Good thing for us, for self-efficacy, we actually have four factors, so we have it identified. The same thing happens. We also have to figure out marker items versus marker for the standardization versus marker item approach for this factor. Still has to be factored in, included in our analysis. The word factor. What do I mean?
we have to go and either set this higher order factor variance to 1 or estimate it by taking one of the higher order loadings and fixing it to 1. Same thing. So it's like it's literally treating each of these factors now as if they were the items in a factor analysis. Oh, and here's another place where I could have mentioned this factor variance. Remember how we had estimated it before? That's no longer unique. That's no longer a factor variance. It's now a unique variance for the higher order model. Right? Just like this item variance is it called a unique variance in a factor analysis. Right? So in a higher order model, this thing is going to be smaller usually than what it would have been. The factor variance is smaller than what it would have been if we didn't have the higher order model in place. So this is another reason why we would use perhaps a marker variable approach, because we want this thing to be estimated so it can shrink and grow, not having to modify everything else as well. Are you following me? Right, so we already know, this is why I dwell on like single factor analysis for several weeks, because you do a bunch of single factor analyses, you put them together, you tweak things a little bit, and you start doing single factor analyses a little bit more. Questions? So, let's keep going here. These are the same identification rules. These are the same slides I used several weeks ago, right? So here are examples of structural model hypothesis tests. Do I have a higher order factor of my subscale factors, right? So this is the question. Do we have a higher order self-efficacy factor? This design was great. We had 4 self-efficacy factors, essentially. So we could test for the presence of a higher order factor, right? If we had 3, we could estimate it, but we couldn't falsify. It would be equivalent to saying there's no higher order factor there and all the covariances are estimated. So if you were developing a test, if you're trying to say, no, really, I have this higher order factor, your test has to have at least 4 factors on it. Or you have to have multiple higher order factors to correlate with it, to test for it. Right? So that's an interesting thing I run into very frequently. A lot of researchers I've worked with, as a stat person, you know, when you work in various departments, you get a lot of people needing help. When I worked in the psych department here, it was all of me, all of my FTE were in psych, and 1/2 of Todd Little. And that meant I got a lot of people who needed help. And so I saw a lot of this, people doing factor analyses, wanting to test for higher order factors, and they had 2 factors in those things. Or they had 3. And again, they're not testable. That's the big difference. Right, there's estimation. We can always estimate it, but we can't test for the present. We can't falsify that's the case. So what you open up, if you have a design like this, you're opening yourself up to the counter argument of, yeah, but there could be a higher order factor, but there could be none. They're both equally plausible. Whereas if we put it in and we can test it, we can falsify there could be none. We can, you know, we can say yes. So we can build it a little bit more. Or at least we could falsify the 1 factor. Pardon me. Forgetting my ordering things. Is this weird with you? I see people sort of talking though. Have you seen this? Yeah, Bridget. No worries, not at all. That's right. 4 is the test. And so the difference is, yeah, so the difference is with 3, you put a higher order factor on, it fits equal to the structure, the saturated model. Whereas 4, now you get a hypothesis test that you can at least reject if need be. 4 is a much stronger argument for why there would be a higher order factor. It's an odd interplay of like philosophy and then actual methodology. Like there's certain rules of methods, mathematical rules that we can't cross the line of, but then at the end of the part of that, now we get into, okay, once we can cross that line, what's the best strength, what's the strongest evidence we can use to say that one thing's the case or not? Other thoughts or questions? Right. Okay, so we're gonna add a higher order self-efficacy, and I'm actually gonna add a higher order math factor too. I'm going crazy over here. Why the higher order math? Because I can. And because when I added the higher order self-efficacy factor, the math side blew up. So I need to reduce the complexity of it. That's one of the things. So you get a model that works, you start adding things to it, it might break all of a sudden. We have a lot of parameters in this. One of the reasons, by the way, of breaking, and this is something Skrupski and I will agree on, if we used a different type of algorithm here, rather than, I mean, we love maximum likelihood. If we used the Bayesian analog of it, it would break less. Right? So use the same likelihood function, put in the Bayes context, we would be able to see where breaking happens a little bit better than maximum likelihood. But I digress. Anyway. So we're going to add that. How do we add it? Well, I mentioned before that when you define a factor, like we did up here with the self-efficacy items, and we did down here with the math items, these things are now treated as they would be items. So our higher order factor just looks like a regular factor line. Right? It's just, we define it, I'm calling this self-esteem, I guess I should, I'm using the terms interchangeably, it's very bad, I shouldn't create slides in the middle of the night. I'm sorry. I'm embarrassed. Anyway. Equal tilde, that says this is becoming a factor, and the thing on the right-hand side of the equal tilde are all the other factors that it's higher than, measured by. Okay? So it's just like they were items. Same thing with math. Now, because of our weird design, though, I need to make it so that the math higher order factor is uncorrelated from the self-efficacy lower order factors, and that the self-efficacy higher order factor is uncorrelated from the math lower order factors. And that's keeping the methods factor from the interest factor apart. That's the reason for that, at least the philosophy I'm using. It's debatable in this case, but I'm just following kind of established practice more than anything else. So that's where you see this additional line of zeros with covariance and this additional set of covariance is set to zero with math. So model 4 is nested within model 3. Model 3 is the saturated version of model 4. So we have a likelihood ratio test we could build, but let's first talk about model fit. And sure enough, wouldn't you know, our model fits. Usually when you get the saturated version of the model to work, the model fit doesn't get that much worse when you put in the higher order versions. Sometimes it does, but not always. Hooray, it fit. The local model fit looks good. And now for the likelihood ratio test. This is the test of whether we need higher order factors or not. And our p-value is 0.4485. This is the likelihood ratio test between model 4 with the higher order factors and model 3 with no higher order factors but unstructured or saturated covariance matrices on the method side and on the self-efficacy side. So this suggests that model 4 fits as well as model 3. So we're able to say, yes, it looks like higher order factors are in place here. Questions? What does that mean for us? Hey, there's a picture. That's what the picture looks like. That thing's a mess too, right? I had to tweak out the lines of things. Higher order factors, first order factors, items. Here's a thought for you. Could we put a third order factor up here? In theory we could. But since we only have 2 second order factors, we can't actually identify it without tricking it. So we wouldn't really be able to do much with that. So what does all this mean? Oh, model parameters. Oh yeah, so finally we have a model that we like. We have a model that we're done with. This model parameters are now where the results are. So we can talk about each of the loadings if we wanted to. Each of the loadings are interpreted the same way. Right? This is the self-esteem 1 factor. This is each of the items that measure self-esteem or self-efficacy 1. And here are all their loadings. Unstandardized, standardized factor or standardized both item and factor. And we can look up these for values that are non-significant if we want to try to improve model fit or whatever else. But generally speaking, we can just leave those alone. Our self self-esteem or self-efficacy higher-order factor, these loadings are interpreted the same way. Right? This is the loading of the first-order self-efficacy factor onto the higher-order factor itself. Questions on parameters? More parameters. Some crazy stuff going on here. Intercepts are only for the items. We fixed all of our factor intercepts to zero. That's part of the identification that we used. Factor intercepts are synonymous with factor means, and so when we fix factor mean to zero, it knocks that thing out. Now we have factor variances. These are unique variances for the items. These are unique variances for the self-efficacy factors. And then we finally have a factor variance at the top. Same thing with math. Our math factor variance is minuscule. May not be needed. And finally, we can talk about R squares. Right? What is the proportion of variation in each of those things accounted for by all the model parameters that go with them? The items, the factor, and the first order factors show up here. One neat thing that you'll see here is one of those cases. We're right on the edge of where things might blow up. Look at the R squared for math factor for question one, it's zero. That means the math higher order factor is not really doing any explanation of it. That thing is like that case where I said if you set a marker loading where you have a zero, we might blow up. We're lucky this worked. I'm surprised it didn't. We could have changed it and made it a little bit easier to identify. All right, Bahira, before I wrap up, what does this mean conceptually? And to the postdoc, who I appreciate working with, this means if you want to measure self-efficacy in mathematics, right, mathematics problem solving, you have to kind of use a complicated design to actually measure self-efficacy. Right? You have a method factor for each of the problems that you might show somebody, and you have sort of method factors for each of the questions of self-efficacy. They're sort of repeated measures, right? But once you factor in the method effects of all that, you can have a one-dimensional, you can have a higher dimension of self-efficacy. And say it's not unidimensional, it's clearly, it's 10-dimensional data. But that self-efficacy portion of it can be talked about by having this higher level of self-efficacy. Once you control for all the design of the research, self-efficacy can be measured. And she can now talk about what it means in terms of measurement, she can talk about what it does in terms of prediction later on and so forth. But that self-efficacy factor, the paper that she wrote with this, I'm thankfully a little bit of an author on. It's under review now. We'll wait till reviewer three gets it. That paper, I was trying to get her to write it so that it talks about, you see a lot of math self-efficacy as a thing, but you can never untangle it from the math that it's part of the self-efficacy. And this is trying to be a methodological tool to say, yes, math self-efficacy is a thing, but once you control for the types of items that you show up with. So that's what I'm trying to get at. It's where I look at this as interpretation. Any questions on that interpretation? Brown? No, not a question.
If you confirm the scale, you wouldn't be able to use a sum score later because they're together.
That's right, no sum scores. Yeah, sum score on this would be very bad because now all of a sudden you bring back the things you're controlling for. Right? And that's actually one thing, I know Hong Ling and I, we had a conversation about this recently. Another reviewer comment is that aren't higher order factors just saying the whole thing's unidimensional? And the answer is no, all right? It's saying that the factors themselves, the first order things, the multiple dimensions might be needing fewer parameters to describe their distribution, but you still need those. It's not equivalent to saying a one factor model fits. And we tested that, we rejected that one factor model. So no, you wouldn't be able to use a sum score on it. That is one of the things, good point on this. One of the things I see very frequently, people do a higher order factor model to say that they can add all their items up and use one score, and that's not the case. So, happens all the time. In fact, people hate me whenever I review comp papers for that. I'm reviewer three for most of it. So wrapping up. Today, multiple factors. I think this is pretty groovy stuff. Right, and I think if Skorupski was here, he'd have to agree. But do you think I would persuade him? Bring this to him and see what he thinks. No.
Or better yet, say, Templin's still not been cracked. What's this?
Multiple factors are just makes the complexity that much higher. The method is always the same. You got to have good unidimensional factors and then put them together, tweak it to make it fit, and then build from there. Next week is exciting to me. Next week, we're going to take factors and put them in analyses with observed variables. That is structural equation model in a nutshell. It's simultaneous equations with or path analysis with latent variables. We're going to be doing that. And so this fits into that where we would have to build a measurement model first before we go put it into such an analysis. Questions before you go? Cool. One final last 40 seconds on my watch. Homework 5 is on the website. It is a multiple dimension factor analysis. And it is very similar to homework 4, it's just with multiple dimensions. Homework 4 being do this, then do this, then do this. Homework 6, I'm excited about because you're going to play the consultant. I'm building this homework, I'm giving you data, and I'm saying, help me with my study. All right, so that's a lot less structured, but hopefully you'll be able to put everything else together with it. Plus, the homeworks, I always like to give you, sometimes I give you hard homework, but thinking you can fix it later on. So, all right, not hard, won't be hard. There's only like 5 variables, so. See you, everybody. That's how it starts.